Greetings, everybody. For me, it's a great honor to be here to talk to you for the second time, because I participated in the Free Generation Forum last year, and I remember it was also a very, very lively crowd. So I think it's a great tradition to have this forum, because I think it can be a great catalyst for further positive changes in the country. Indeed, I believe, I hold myself as a libertarian minister. Last year I was no libertarian minister because I was no minister. But this is my principal stance. I believe in the ideas of libertarianism. Let me tell you at once, it's not easy at all to be a libertarian minister in Ukraine, especially a minister of finance, because it is believed that the minister of finance is the most conservative position in the government, and especially now when we need to cut the costs. Maybe we should adjust the volume a little bit. So when you you're forced to cut the costs, it is the job of Ministry of Finance, and we have to be conservative to the max. But on the other hand, there will be no reform through cost cutting alone. So we need to plan the reforms for the future. And that means the easiest way to do it is from the position of a Minister of Finance, because you can talk, you can try to popularize whatever you want, but the changes are only happening where the money flows, and considering what are the conditions and the environment for this money created. This is the forum, as I read in the leaflets. It's going to be discussions about the past, the future, and the present. But I don't believe I'm a big expert in matters of history, although I have read a lot of historical books, but I think we should focus on today, and I think we should focus on tomorrow, because there are too many discussions about the past, and they don't help us at all. That's my personal opinion. We really have to think about today and tomorrow, because it is today that we create the future. And things you are doing, you are creating today, are becoming the future tomorrow. And the changes happen in the modern world almost instantly. You make a mistake today, and the consequences hit you tomorrow. That's the way the world operates right now. Everything's happening faster. And that's why 2.5 years after the revolution of dignity, well, it's almost 3 years now, a lot of things have been done, but you also have to understand that it's too little that has been done at the same time. And we need a lot of catching up to do. And that's not an easy job. It's not an easy job because people are getting tired. The prime time for change is when the people are hot in their wish to do change. Now there's a little bit of fatigue in the society, but if you look at people right now, the government that we have right now is the government that took the burden of the most complex and most difficult reforms. The tariffs, the pension reform, the land market. So these are the reforms that we had been talking for years, but let's not touch it at the time. But it's time now, and to do it with full responsibility. But we forgot, or I forgot to mention several very important spheres of activity. Education and health protection. And that's where I want to get back to Where does the Minister of Finance stand in this process? The Ministry of Finance in many countries, especially in the developed countries, the ministry is a very strong unit. It has a very strong mandate. Historically in Ukraine, the Ministry of Finance, well, it's some kind of accounting department. I have a lot of claims. Why have you done this? Why haven't you done this? You are stopping this and that. You didn't pay this and that. If I'm an accountant, then yeah, I have to look at the invoice. Yeah, I did not pay this because I'm a Minister of Finance. I don't have to do it. My job is not to pay it, but to ask you, why do you need this money? This is the money of taxpayers. What do you need this money for? What will be the result? And if there is a clear understanding that this is the money that's going to be spent on something right, on something necessary, like the positive reform, then yes, I will give a green light. If not, then no. So that means that the Minister of Finance is not an accountant. The Minister of Finance is a driver of change in the country, and that's what we're trying to build now in our ministry. That's my objective, and I think that we are quite successful in achieving this. And we're not only changing the Ministry of Finance itself, but also we're trying to reformat the government itself, the whole of the power structure. We're teaching them. We're teaching them because the budgetary process is not a race against time. Who's the first to grab the money? Who's holding the grudge because your neighbor grabbed the money first? Or let's split the money and run? No, it's planning. We're sitting together. We're talking through what we want to do. If we're talking about the reform of education, let's talk about this reform. Let's talk about education. Because reforming the education is not social reform. It's about economy. People are getting educated in order to use their education in their life, not just to put a plastic diploma in a drawer, or even worse, run around with three diplomas advertising diplomas. I can't find a job. I have three diplomas. What kind of country is that? You look at those diplomas and you see the names of institutions that nobody knows, but the person is so confident that these three diplomas give him this stand to advertise as a triple specialist. No, but it does happen. And talking about the educational reform, we even had some scandals recently. I remember the story, the scandal with student stipendiums. My deputy knows it too much. And I told him, you want to walk around with a plastic cup and give tea to everyone. But we have also learned a lot in the process, because first of all, we were open for the dialogue, because we stated from the start we're about to do the reform of education, and we explained why. Why is it that the stipendium system in Ukraine is so ineffective? We explained why. We said that it's not possible that 70% of our students receive academic stipendiums. Only if you study well, if you produce some results, but it's not possible that 70% receive premium stipendiums. But there are also part of the students who really need social support, and that level of stipendium doesn't give them that support. So let's separate a social part, and there's academic part. And you know what? We received a lot of negative remarks at once. We started to explain ourselves, and a lot of people agreed with us because they realized what we're talking about. But there were also people who I was very surprised by them. They seemed like young, smart people, but you talk to them and you realize that you hit a wall, that person will not change anything because they don't want to change anything. They're passive. They're idle. They will get this little right now and they don't care about the future. He will hold for this little piece right now. And you understand that we are now facing the generation that is bound to either change the country as free people or fail. But free people have to take... Freedom brings responsibility. Free people need to be ready to take responsibility because free people are not the mass. And the mass is something that the populists appeal to. I think populists are dangerous as nuclear weapons. They should be banned because, as in a duel, you know, 200 years ago, when you're a duelist, each of the duelists have to choose the weapons, but the weapons should be the same. And the one to win will be the one who's more skilled. Only those who are better skilled, they will win. What the populist is, remember Indiana Jones, where the Arab guy is swashbuckling that sword, and then the Indiana just takes and shoots him. That's populist. In order to battle the populist, you have to, you know, overthrow him with everything you got, like double, triple your energy. And that's what we're doing. We're tripling our energy to explain people what's the right thing to do. Because populists, they appeal to the mass, and it's the easiest way for the mass, the easiest message that they push. And talking to people, I've realized a lot of things. And I'm confident that education is our main reform. The reform of education is the most important one. And we gotta build strong specialists. Not some passive people who hold on to their plastic diploma, but active people who will be using the money that is invested in them to build the new Ukraine. And you, as I understand, because I see a lot of students here or graduates, you have to understand this one thing. Freedom and liberty is responsibility, because with freedom comes commitment. And freedom is also the strength. Let me tell you why freedom is strength, I believe. Because in the 21st century, to be free is to be strong. We're living in a globalized world. Everybody's caring about their own private interests. And that is the right thing to do. Ukraine has to take care, has to stand for her interest. We're a sovereign state. We should steer free from dictatorship, from international organizations, and create our own reforms agenda. I don't judge IMF, and I support their program. I support what we've been doing with the World Bank and other international partners. But people take it as a dictatorship. I take it as a partnership, and the government takes it as a partnership. But it's very important to have your own agenda. Not what IMF wants, but what the people of our country want. And we have this agenda now, and we communicate this agenda very actively. Next thing, as I said, freedom. With freedom comes responsibility and commitment. Even take the changes that we're driving, the healthcare. We declare that we want to steer away from funding the facilities to funding the services. What's the total square mile of all the healthcare facilities in Ukraine? It's the territory of Estonia, basically. All of our healthcare institutions, they cover the same territory as Estonia. and we're using our money, our taxpayers' money, to heat those facilities. And in most cases, those are just facilities. It's just a box. Doesn't have any. Doesn't even have medicines. And this is where the Ukrainian citizens come to get some service done. And it seems to be. It's supposed to be free, but there he goes to that hospital, and there's a tall bill that they face. This is how much you should pay for this and this and this. And this system has to be changed. Do you think that many people support that? No, they don't. People don't believe. People don't believe that it's possible. And it's our job to convince them. And in order to convince it, you got to be open. You got to witness what's happening outside of Ukraine. And it's your job also. In order to be stronger, you have to see the world. You have to understand the global trends, what's happening around. Because every time I come to Washington or London to do negotiations, you can't lay some Ukrainian problems or vision to the table because the world is changing so fast. You have to monitor what's happening there. If you're a partner, you have to understand what's happening in the world, and only then you can talk as equal. And only then you can stand for the interests of Ukraine. If you come there and wait till everybody speaks out and say, this is what we need, that's the loser's strategy. And you gotta learn to take the winning strategy from the start. If you're a university student, look around the world. What are the trends? What's happening? I don't understand how can you be a polytechnical student and not know anything about technological breakthroughs in the world. You live in the golden age of information. We've never dreamed about this way back when. Use it. That's your future. Don't look at these obsolete, old, yellow page books from Soviet times. That's bag of bricks. That's why I'm nitpicking at the stipendium issues. I remember I was a student in Polytechnica. From the third year, I became a student of another economic institute. And I was hesitating for a while. What did I want more, engineering degree or economics? And I couldn't choose one, so I went for both. And it took me a whole day to study. Then I started working. Then I went to the U.S. to study. And American government paid for me, and I'm thankful for that. I'm really thankful. I received a stipendium, and my studies were covered for. I was there for 2 years. How are American students looked at me, you can only guess. They came to business school. They came with debt because you accumulate debt before you get the bachelor degree. And here's me coming from Ukraine, all paid by American government. So I'm there for free. And some of my colleagues also did the same way. They used that opportunity. But what I did, I found in summer, I found some job on the Wall Street. I made some money there, a little bit. And the American government, as a sponsor, looked at that story and said, "Oh, we're not sponsoring anymore because you were making money, obviously." And that's it. The second time, I was a student without financial support. Do you think I suffered from that? No, I felt myself as a free person because I came there, and I'm not the suckling pig who's using the system. I gained some useful experience. And I learned to make money, and I paid for myself. That empowers me, and that gives me freedom. So I think that's the way our youth, our students, and young people should... that's the stance you have to take. Be active and be strong. Now, regarding the Ministry of Finance, we're looking for such people right now. We're hiring. We created an office of reform at our ministry, and everybody who wants to join in, I'm very open, but we do have high standards, but anyone who's interested, I'm ready for you joining the team. All of our policy is open. All of our initiatives are discussed openly with experts, with society, so if there's anyone in the audience who believe themselves to be experts or are experts, please join in to the discussion about our initiatives. As soon as you are a member of the team, you got to understand that openness is our value. So you should be, and you are expected to be, as open as we are. And look, we all have to get stronger and more free, because your generation and next generation should be free people. That's our goal, and that's my goal as well. Thank you. Thank you. We have some questions and answers. State yourself and ask your question. Taras Tretiak, Kyiv National Shevchenko University. It's great that there's this opportunity to talk to you. I got two questions regarding your particular position in your ministry. Are you planning the multi-currency in Ukraine to cancel the civil code that the hryvnia is the only way to pay? And open the way to pay in any currency that your counterpart wants. Let's take one question at a time. Now, one very short question to follow up. As far as I understand, the budget provisions for military needs, only 5% from GDP is required for the military budget. But we believe that it's too little, because Russia spends 12% of GDP for the military needs. And that small percentage, 5%, is paid for by blood of our soldiers. So the question is, do you think it's too little? And do we need to go for multi-currency? Do you share that idea that we have to go for multi-currency and increase our army expenditures? Well, I wanted to answer these two questions. Maybe they're contradictory, don't you think? Look, let's talk military budget first. That's true. The risks and the reality that we face, the Russian aggression, forces us to renew our army, to rebuild our security system, and all of those elements, the army and the defense sector, should be top effective. And that can be done by several ways. Either spend more funds or spend more effectively. So I believe that we are limited in what we can pay. We have very limited resources. And we have resource appetites in other spheres as well, where the reforms should be driven. So next year, this year, let's say, it's not only 5%. We increased funding for the military from 114 billion hryvnia to 129 billion hryvnia. We added 15 billion. And that's a significant resource. And I believe that money, it should be spent more effectively. I think we did what was supposed to be done, what was needed. We allocated additional resources, but also we expect a more effective use of that money. So together with the Ministry of Defense and Ministry of Foreign Affairs, we discussed how to use it more effectively. I don't think it's too little. Of course, more would be desirable, but the spending that we have, I think it's an optimal amount. As soon as the opportunity arrives, we will allocate more funds. Regarding the multi-currency system, I forgot where I am. There are a lot of such interesting ideas circulating around. And I remain libertarian. I do support interesting, unorthodox ideas, but every time I answer your question right here on this stage, I have to realize that I'm a minister, and there's reality to grapple with. And the reality is that we have to do the topmost must do.
There are lots of things we have to do and can do, but we have to, first of all, to do basic things. And our priority for the next 2 years is the reform of education, public health reform, reform of the army, and reform of the energy sector. And launching and actually starting up a lot of new business here. Everything, and we have to help to do it, and not to do just minor things, but we have to focus on the key things. Amendments to the tax code, which we have submitted to the parliament 3 weeks ago, it's just fundamental change. It's the change to the philosophy of the work of the state tax administration, and it actually is going to eliminate the opportunities for corruption in the state tax administration. And the effect of this new code, tax code, this new draft law, is going to be especially high. And this is what business expects from us to do. When we do all these basic things, then we can go back to sort of, how can I put it, not straightforward things. Well, the ideas which are not interpreted in a single manner. Thank you for your speech. You said that you are the Minister Libertarian, and do you agree that the taxes is just an instrument to rob the people? And as a Minister of Finance, a Libertarian Minister of Finance, what is your feeling when you are managing the money which has been stolen? In the second question is about a more efficient use of money in the area of defense. In the Soviet Union, there were 150 of generals. In the US, there are the strongest army in the world has 40 generals, admirals. In Ukraine, we have 400. So this is a task for the Ministry of Finance. I would like to answer your question with a question. Don't sit down. And was it pleasant for you to get educated using the money which has been stolen, to be protected by the army in the east of Ukraine, which is financed by the stolen money? The money which was paid for my education was stolen from my parents, and your grandmas and grandpas and your parents are getting the pension, which is financed from the stolen money. So we are accomplices then. Did you pay for your education on your own? And in your childhood, the outpatient clinics where paying it by They were financed from the tax money. Your parents, grandfathers, and grandmothers are my accomplices. I understand that. And your estimates. And you are a young man. You have been studying at school, and you were financed by the state money. But the state robs the people from the money, and then they are paying peanuts for the people to be loyal. Maybe you can rethink your question a little bit. I don't want to be liked by people. You just think about your question yourself. I'm saying that any politics has to be responsible. You're now talking on a very populist level. You are even more populist than Madame Tymoshenko is. But I haven't heard your answer. I am answering the questions which have sense, but I didn't see any sense in you. You're saying that all the taxes are stolen money. Again, you are even more populist than the biggest populist in this country. Well, I hope that this Q&A session is not going to be your sort of long star. We are going to use the website pidrahuy.org, and that's the calculator to show how the taxes are being spent. We would like to decrease the taxes, but it is impossible to bring them to zero rate. And you will see how the taxes are being spent and what needs to be done to make it efficient. Oleksandr Danyliuk from Odessa. At this particular moment, reanimation package of reform together with the Ministry of Sports and Youth are actually discussing the law on youths. Oh, goodness gracious, how can you live, young guys, without a law? I'm really scared. As a libertarian, I can understand how you can live without a law. This law envisages that the graduate of the university is going to get a job, and for the first year of his career, the employer is not going to pay contributions to the social funds for them. And this will ease for the graduates to get the employment. This amount is going to be used for the youth projects, which is being saved. All the range of various projects. Whether the Ministry of Finance is going to support this law and whether you are prepared to amend the budget code. So what's the question? To what extent the Ministry of Finance supports the fund for support of youths? This is an additional task for us to support the youths too. And the first question was about could you remind me of your first question? Yeah, please. I even don't want to read that draft law. After the first employment, the graduate, the employer of the graduate, if it is the first employment, is not going to pay contributions to the social funds because that will make it easier for the graduates to find the first job. I've been working since I was 18 or 19. This is where I started to work. Yeah, well, when I was the second year student, I started to work. You believe in yourself. If you can bring a value to business, they will hire you. All these privileges, these strong people get jobs and they are going to change, but those who are not getting employed and those who will try to find some tools to save payment of the social or contributions to the social funds, they will be employed. At least on paper, all the graduates will be employed, and the businesses are going to optimize the payment of their taxes. But in reality, it's going to be a corrupt scheme. You forgot that I am libertarian. And I remember 12 months ago, the audience was libertarian and believe any privileges of this kind, it's a negative approach. It simply deprives people of incentives, of motivation. And there are no incentives for the businesses because they are not going to look for the best specialists and the most talented ones. But they will think, oh, out of this crowd, I can hire than 7, 8, or 10 people and multiply it by the tax rate. And then they will save this money on tax schemes. But you are the future of this country. Become strong specialists, and then you're going to be hired. If not here, you will find a job outside this country because this is a free world. I left Ukraine at a certain point of time because there were no conditions for me to get an employment, but I came back. And that's a normal process. You just think about your own development and don't think what the state can do for you. We are talking about the effective state, and the more opportunities you give the state to help you, the worse life you are going to have. Good morning. My question is the following. You're telling that you're a libertarian and you keep actually repeating it, but your rhetorics contradicts libertarianism because you're saying that in the system of education it is necessary to cancel the scholarships. I agree to you, but you are saying that it's necessary to provide the funds to the people who need social assistance, whether they are intelligent or not. But I think that this is an improper usage of state funds. Comment on that. I will be happy to. And you talked about the land reform. You saw, told that this is a sore point, these issues have been raised all the time, and at present you have to resolve it. But unfortunately, I cannot see any changes in this respect because the parliament extends this moratorium all the time. And thank you very much for this question. First of all, ye proceed from the principle that Let me start anew. By the way, I'm not a supporter of cancellation of the scholarships. I told from the very beginning I'm against it. But these scholarships have to be academic scholarships. They should create incentives for those who demonstrate good academic results. And he's quoting a popular song of a Soviet bard that we have to provide incentives to these people by economic scholarships, but social scholarships. And I didn't say that everybody has to obtain the scholarship, no matter what the academic records are. But now I'm trying to show you where you have mistaken. Those people who do not show any good academic records, should not be enrolled into the university. We don't need them a priori. But those who are studying and demonstrating some academic record and comply with the level required, if they are within low income brackets. Everything is very simple. These are realistic situations in life. And this, by the way, could be done not by the Ministry of Education, but it could be resolved by the Ministry of Social Protection and social policies. They look at the financial situation in the family. So those people who have to be supported, and this is the way the whole world operates. We cannot hear those shouts from the crowd. They don't use the microphone. But the minister says it's not true. Look, in reality, it's the opposite. In principle, the whole world works in the following way. They try to provide equal opportunities. No, wait a minute. I'm not saying that those who are studying badly has to obtain the social scholarship or social support. Well, those who are showing poor economic academic record should not be kept in the university. But those who are studying well, but unfortunately they do not have means for existence, they should be supported by the social assistance. Or because they are studying, they cannot find a job yet, or they are disabled people, and that's correct. And another example from from foreign countries. Do you have a question? If people need money, so the state has to provide the money, and you believe that this is libertarianism, but this is social protection. But libertarianism, you well, where? So where is libertarians? You are the minister, a libertarian, but not socialist. I am responsible for this country, as well as the whole government is, and this means that those who cannot support themselves. But no, not those who don't want to work, but they cannot take care of themselves for certain reasons. The state has to support them. This is about the disabled, for example. Or do you believe that the veterans who has been disabled, and you will be discussing libertarianism here, but who is going to take care about the disabled? Do you know how many disabled we have? Well, unfortunately, we cannot hear what the crowd is saying. I am saying that there are very different categories of citizens. At present, we have to support the inclusive education. The disabled children, do you believe that they should be kicked out into the street? Is this this is the function of the state? Do you like Europe, the United States? These people are integrated, and the state provides special funds to integrate those people into the society, and then the society is going to be more healthy. And libertarianism means that not people are all enemies, but libertarianism, it means that there will be a small state apparatus, but very effective, and the business and this country should be free for business and for the people. Well, if you give support to everybody who needs something, is this the function of the state, or your major function is the good governance with a small apparatus? So don't discuss the veterans of war and the students who have no funds. These are different things, but I'm talking about the social protection. The function of the state is to protect the population when the war was waged and the person lost his or her health, and the students have go and work and get their money somewhere. I'm not going to protect or defend. You have been students. If in your group you cannot find a colleague of yours who would have the right for social assistance, then it means I'm mistaken. I agree. Yeah, then I agree that I'm mistaken, but I'm not sure that it's not exactly the case in the situation. There are students who need social support, and this is not the function of the Ministry of Finance, by the way. The function of the Ministry of Finance is the following, and this is where you are going to agree to me, I hope, and don't be that excited and nervous. Yeah. It is necessary at present to discriminate between these two things. At present, everything is consolidated. We have 82% of students, the 82% of the graduates of schools, high schools, go to the universities. 70% of those get the scholarships. What does that mean? So we have to divide these things. If you believe that in Ukraine there are no children who need to get some social protection, well, you know, but there are certain criteria. If people comply with those criteria, they provide social they obtain the social assistance. The last question, the lady in the first row. I'm sorry, her microphone is not working, so we cannot hear the wisdom of her question, sorry. Maybe we will hear the wisdom of the answer. No. Can you hear my answer? I have one question to you. You are responsible for the policy of the debt. And each Ukrainian has a debt. It is more than 2,000 dollars per person, and in 2017 it will be necessary to pay the principal of the loan and the interest of the loan. So what are the tools you're going to use in terms of debt policies, restructuring, refinancing? So everything is being financed from the state budget. And the second question, your vision about the IMF loans, it's the creditor of the last instance, and the land issue is also the requirement of the IMF. Do you support all the conditionalities and prior actions of the IMF? And well, and for us, the debt has increased by the factor of four. Those who have not heard, something happens with the mic, so I will try to sort of repeat your question, and you will tell me if I'm right or wrong. You were talking about the debt policy, that Ukraine at present increases its state debt, and what my vision is of how we are going to repay, and what's the policy as far as the debt is concerned. And the second question, whether I am supporting the programs of the IMF. First of all, let us talk about the debt policy. As far as the funds we collect from taxpayers and the funds which we borrow, so I treat them similarly, and I believe that they should be effectively and efficiently used. That's why I don't support just thoughtless borrowing. I don't support it. It's the question of not financing, but it's not the question of borrowing, but it's the question of using these funds. We are going to repay the debts from the revenues we will get at the end of the day. So if we look at the IMF programs of the end of 2000, 2008, when 4-5 billion were borrowed just in one go, wow. So it's an obsolete approach. We are fed up with it. If we are borrowing at present, we, first of all, are not borrowing at that scope, that large amounts. And mostly, all the funds of the IMF are being channeled not into the budget, but into the reserves of the National Bank. And I believe it's a correct policy. My vision is that we have to live at our own expense and borrow only absolutely necessary amounts at this particular phase. And this is not only about the IMF. At present, we are reviewing the portfolio of the World Bank loans. And there are a lot of loans. Actually, disbursement is very low there, because a lot of loans which we have agreed many years ago, and we have now to complete the program to get the money. It would have been good, yeah, well, to get all those money which was committed. Well, but my position is a position of principle. Let us review each project. If it's not topical at present, we just cancel it, and we free the resources and finance only those projects which are crucial now. We did not want to finance the priorities of the past. There is quite a unique project. It's like, do you remember this Air Express? This was the funds not of the World Bank, but the Chinese loan, yeah? It's like Air Express. Do you remember that project? It's still alive. So, for you to understand. So look at the reality in which Ukraine lives at present. Do we need to borrow to build this Air Express? Is this the only infrastructural project which we need to implement to start our economy working? Or do we have any other priorities? Ministry of Finance at present analyzes all the projects, and those which are not topical for today, which did not give impetus for the development of the economy, are being cancelled. One of my acquaintances said he had an example. He used to quote an example. We worked for McKinsey together with him when he and his wife went to a Christmas sale. And she said, well, we need to buy this and this and this. And he said that if it's cheap, it doesn't mean we need it. If this resource is there, it doesn't mean that we have immediately used this resource. Even the funds which we are borrowing are to be repaid, so we have to be very careful about borrowing. And we have to be very careful in spending them as well as we have to treat the funds of the taxpayers. Even more more responsible, because usually we pay interest rates, so we will have to repay more than we have borrowed. This conversation becomes private. This lady is not using the mic. First of all, we are now reviewing the portfolios, credit portfolios, and we are planning to enter the debt market, not because it's absolutely necessary for us. We have quite a disciplined policies now, and we do not have just a urgent need to borrow. We simply would like to borrow a little bit to actually tell the market that Ukraine is in this market. It's a signal to the investors, to the market, that Ukraine is a stable state, and there is a demand for our bonds in the debt markets, in the so, just to put it shortly, it's a conservative borrowing policy. Just one more question. But ask a nice question so I can give a positive answer. Very short question. You were saying that you are libertarian and you are decreasing the expenditures and you fight populism, but you have submitted a new budget to the parliament where the expenditures $775 billion, and it's 16% more than last year. Last year it was $667 billion. So why are you lying? Thank you very much for a good and kind question. The last question. Yeah, thank you very much for that. It would have been interesting for you to discuss these issues among yourselves, because some people say it's not sufficient financing of the army, let us cancel the social support. It means that the audience here is not preaching the same, values. It's true that the expenditures have increased. I can even tell you that when we started to work with the budget, these expenditures were lower. And actually, at a certain point of time, the Ministry of Finance created a line of defense to protect the budget from the additional expenditures. Should you know what was planned to be done, you could have evaluated the efforts of the Ministry of Finance to make this budget realistic. So the draft budget you see now, it's an interim result, so you don't know what has been done to sort of curb it. It's a reality, and it's a balance between the idealism and reality. As an idealist, one comes to the ministry with certain ideas, and you have to fight not every hour of your life, but every minute of your life. The budget committee, one deputy, comes at the last moment and says, "Let us hear, look at the opportunity immediately to change this budget line." And I'm saying, okay, stop, what did you say? And you see that it was an imperative norm, which is going to cost $10 billion in the budget, to the budget. That's why I don't want to lie. Actually, I'm trying not to lie at all. I am saying that this is a very difficult job, and it's an incessant struggle every second. Secondly, as for And very few people understand that here, but I will try to explain. Because we have to look into the budget. We do not open all the budget lines here. For example, financing of the salaries of the teachers, which were increased. And the source. What's the source? Do you understand how the system of financing has changed? Do you understand that at present, the expenditures have been pushed to the local budgets? We have balanced it. It's not popular, but we've done that. And that's a very important part of the reform. Secondly, the salaries of the teachers have been raised, which is very good. It's very correct. How did we finance it? The state order for the next year is going to decrease in the university. We understand that 82% of the graduates of the high schools cannot study in the universities. So some of these expenditures are part of the reform, and inside the budget they balance each other. That's why we have to be much more careful in studying this budget. It's not an ideal budget, but a lot of work has been put into it to make it realistic.